Welcome again to Japanese for Nikkei's Nikkei Spotlight Series. My name is Mimi Okabe, and I'm one of the co-founders of JFN, which is an online teaching and learning platform for Nikkei learners of the Japanese language. So the Nikkei Spotlight Series was really created with our desire to connect and learn more about our community members. It's an initiative to celebrate the voices of those who identify as Nikkei or those who have mixed Japanese heritage from around the world. And our vision is to really spread awareness about professionals in our communities, including but not limited to artists, authors, and academics who are breaking barriers and doing formative work to help raise awareness of a global Japanese diaspora. So if you have anyone in mind whom you would like us to consider inviting in the future, please get in touch with us. Today, we are very humbled and very grateful to have Drs. Aurora Tsai and Yuki Yamazaki deliver a talk entitled Hafu Women's Collective Healing from Ethnolinguistic Discrimination Through a Translanguaging Safe Space. I'll turn it over to Sachi to introduce our speakers, then we'll begin the presentation.
All right. Hello, everyone, and thanks so much for joining. My name is Sachi. I am also a co-founder for Japanese for Nikkei. And Mimi and I, Aurora, as well as Yuki, are all very happy to have you all with us today. So Dr. Aurora Tsai is a project assistant professor at the University of Tokyo who identifies as American and Japanese with European and Taiwanese Hakka roots. Her research focuses on intersections of race, language, and identity, focusing primarily on the experiences of multicultural and multi-ethnic language users. Dr. Yuki Yamazaki is a counseling psychologist completing her American Psychological Association accredited internship at Manhattan Psychiatric Center and is a lecturer at NYU's Steinhardt School of Culture, Education, and Human Development. She identifies as Japanese and Indian American. Her clinical and research areas focus on microaggression and stereotype experiences of mixed and or multiracial people of Asian descent and the impact of discrimination on mental health. Before we begin their talk, I will lay out the structure of the next hour or so very briefly. We ask that you listen attentively and feel free to ask questions by typing them in the chat. Just keep in mind that your questions will be addressed at the end of our speaker's presentation during the Q&A session. Please keep your mics muted while our speakers present. And we also ask that you keep questions respectful. Please also treat others with respect, love, and kindness. JFN has zero tolerance policy against racism and other forms of discrimination. So without further ado, Dr. Tsai and Yamazaki, please take it away.
Hey, thank you so much, Mimi and Sachi. I'm just gonna share my screen, so a second, please. Okay, and can you see that okay? Okay, great. Great. So yeah, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And thank you everyone in the audience for being here today. It's really such an honor and we are very excited to present for you. My name is Aurora Tsai and I'm a researcher in applied linguistics at the University of Tokyo. And
I'm Yuki Yamazaki. I have just finished my PhD in counseling psychology at Fordham University.
Okay. And Mimi and Sachi already introduced, we're going to talk about Hafu Women's Collective Healing from Ethnolinguistic Discrimination through what we call a translanguaging safe space. Right, and just to give you a preview of our presentation today, we're first going to spend some time talking about, well, our specific study that we carried out, and that includes an overview of some of the historical and modern day stereotypes that are often associated with Hafu in Japan. We'll talk about our methods, and we'll also actually share some audio clips where we present some stories shared by Hafu women as they're working in Japanese companies. Right? And we'll talk about some of the racism, sexism, and linguistics discrimination described by these Hafu women. Also how they achieve collective healing and empowerment through their discussion. And at the same time, why they weren't able to heal from all aspects of internalized shame. So we'll talk in detail about why that happens and what the implications are for language learning context as well as counseling. And the last part, we hope just have 35 minutes for the study and then 25 minutes we will have for Q&A. And we'd love, if there's time, to have a collective discussion with the audience focusing on this question: how does learning and understanding the intersectional experiences of Hafu women expand and broaden the definition of Nikkei? So I think many of you may know the term Hafu, but just in case some people don't, this is a Japanese word that it was adopted from the English word half, and it's commonly used to describe multiracial Asians, usually someone who has one Japanese parent and one non-Japanese parent.
So we're going to talk briefly about the history of stigma towards Hafu and really emphasizing the negative stigma that we're going to talk about at the beginning and shifting into the more positive stereotypes that we're kind of living in today. And so that although there are other terms that have been used throughout Japanese history, like konketsuji or daburu to refer to Hafus, the term Hafu is most widely used by both monoracial and multiracial and multi-ethnic Japanese. Historically, Hafus were seen in Japan as unfortunate offspring between American military and Japanese women who had children out of wedlock from, and we're talking more specifically in the latter 1800s to after World War II. The image of Hafu started to shift with the advent and exposure to mass media in the 1970s and 1980s through Hafu models and celebrities. And we see that still growing today. As we see here, this is just a screen grab of celebrity Hafus. And as you can see just visually, that the way that Hafus are just portrayed today, we see them as predominantly female. A stat we have is 75% of Hafus identify as female. And 85% identify having being from part European descent. And although that's not maybe the full makeup of Hafus, that's what we are seeing more in the media. And from there, we start to see some of these more positive stereotypes of Hafus today, like that they are beautiful, charming, that they're half and half, meaning half white, half Japanese, best of both worlds, and can speak Japanese and English fluently, and have this kind of global citizen air to them.
Right, so there are a lot of positive stereotypes about Hafus, but not necessarily positive for Hafu themselves. And we see this in a lot of the pressure that Hafu might have living up to some of these quote unquote positive stereotypes. For example, Christine Marie Inzer is a graphic novelist and she actually demonstrated in her lived experiences where she's looking at this poster of a Hafu model and she thinks to herself, is this what I'm supposed to look like? Right. So yeah, there can be a lot of pressure associated with these stereotypes, but actually not only, you know, beauty related stereotypes, but there's also a lot of pressure when thinking about language-related stereotypes and expectations. So I'm going to show another clip from Inzer's graphic memoir. And before I do, I just want to give some context. So she goes to a Japanese lesson and she performs horribly during the Japanese lesson that she goes to with her dad. And her dad tries to console her and says, Christine, it's only Japanese. And this is her reply. No, it's not. It's really not just that. I am humiliated with myself. I just want to be good enough and I'm not. Every time I try to say something, I feel like a failure. I know I'm not really Japanese and I don't know why I keep trying when all I do is disappoint you and mom. Okay, so I think some of what she's saying here really resonates with me and a lot of heritage language learners. Because not only Hafu, but many multilinguals, heritage language learners in the US especially, are often perceived as unbalanced or quote unquote linguistically deficient by majority groups. Okay. And multiracials in particular often feel pressured to express their linguistic skills to a quote unquote native-like degree in order to prove their belonging to different ethnic groups. Right, so in this study, we focus on how Hafu navigates language-related stereotypes and pressure using intersectionality and translanguaging as a theoretical stance. And when I talk about translanguaging, I'm referring to a concept that refers to multilingual competence that emerges when, you know, these multiple languages we're using and other resources are used flexibly for communication in different social contexts. So this isn't just code switching, like switching between languages like Japanese and English, but it's actually transformative because using these multiple linguistic and semiotic resources like gestures or you know signs, this kind of communication is actually celebrated rather than viewed as a sign of linguistic deficiency. And it's also a political stance. It's actively resisting this one nation equals one language equals one identity type ideology that originated from Western colonization. So our motivation for this study was first because scholars at large are calling for the decolonization of classrooms, anti-racist pedagogies, and empowerment of multilingual minorities. And also because in our context, little is known about how we can effectively achieve this for Japanese multiracials and heritage language learners who may have difficulty finding a supportive community where translanguaging is embraced as a lived reality.
So therefore we have two main research questions going into our study. The first is what types of experiences and attitudes do Hafu women express related to their racial, gender, and linguistic identities? And second, how do Hafu women use a translanguaging space as a place for collective healing and empowerment? And based on our findings, we argue that first, gendered and racialized stereotypes of Hafu women can lead to internalized shame. We don't live up to the cultural, gendered, and linguistic expectations. And secondly, systemic linguistic discrimination is often an under-discussed component of these safe spaces for the healing and empowerment of multiracials, particularly when there are intersectional experiences of racism and sexism, which we are going to highlight in our study with you today. So briefly kind of going into our methods, for our participants, we were looking for people to participate, any person that identified as a woman, part Japanese, and had basic knowledge of both English and Japanese. We advertised our study as an online Hafu ladies exchange in a Facebook group community, we specifically recruited within that, and that who we recruited from our recruitment strategy was 20 cisgendered women, and yes, and all identified as multi-ethnic Japanese women. And we asked everyone to rate their language comfort levels. And below you can see the English average and the Japanese average, with 5 being native-like speaking for all the participants. And within the exchange itself, we met weekly for 4 weeks. And these exchanges occurred over Zoom. And within these meetings, we asked the participants to discuss a set of questions that we presented to them ahead of time around a specific theme. So everyone came to the exchange prepared in some way for the session. The participants were put into breakout rooms during our sessions of 2 to 4 people and asked to discuss these sets of questions. Participants were asked to write down their answers before coming to sessions again to be prepared ahead of time. And in order to create a safe space, we asked and we co-collaborated on creating ground rules at the first meeting. And these rules drew on concepts of translanguaging and group safety. Our goal was to aim to lower anxiety towards speaking in one language, to normalize the home language practices of multilingual minorities, to promote psychological liberation from oppression and engagement in radical healing by connecting with people from similar ethnic backgrounds and experiences, especially highlighted, as Aurora has said, with the unique intersection of all these identities, and create a space for the construction of resistant values and knowledge.
Great. So for our data analysis, actually, first, we wanted to note that both of the authors strongly identify as multiracial Japanese women who were raised mainly in the US. Yeah. And that shapes the way that we are able to interact with participants and make sense of the data. We started with a broad thematic analysis based on our exchange sessions that we recorded. And the authors and the research assistants that we had, we met regularly over 8 months to narrow down prominent themes within the data and then find some narratives that expressed these themes. We did a narrative analysis. So we selected two narratives to analyze using Bamberg and Georgia Coppola's three-step positioning analysis, which we'll talk about later. And we also did member checking, where we interviewed two of our participants who shared the narratives, and we asked them how much they agreed with our findings and interpretations. I would say overall, they expressed agreement. They also helped us interpret parts of the narratives that we were a little bit shaky on based on the audio alone. And they helped us provide feedback on how much they felt like the online environment was a safe space as we intended. And I would say overall, the feedback was positive. It's hard to summarize everything. And maybe the biggest challenge was trying to balance Japanese and English and figure out how much to use which language based on what topic and who you're speaking with. So typical things when it comes to communication in any situation.
So going into, we're gonna share now some of the transcripts and our results to give you some context and background. We wanted to first let you know that this conversation was during the first meeting after our participants had a chance to introduce themselves and talk casually for 30 minutes. Our participants were given a list of questions, as we said before, to talk about and asked to focus on one of the questions they found the most interesting. The question that all of our participants are responding to is, have you ever felt ashamed for not speaking English or Japanese as well as you felt you should? And these are three Hafu women in conversation about this question. And so the first speaker we're going to hear from is J1. We're not actually going to do a full deep dive into her narrative, but we want to just share some context about her story. She shares a story about how she interviewed with a Japanese company and felt shame about her Japanese skills in this story.
Shall I play it?
Sure.
This is jumping ahead, but for the third question, when they're talking about shame for not speaking English or Japanese as well, early in the pandemic, or like a couple months into the pandemic, I quit my job and I had a job interview for a position that did not involve the Japanese language in and of itself. But I would have had to work with vendors in Japan. So I used to work in print production, and this was a print production position at a company that was in the United States for a Japanese property. And I had to do a phone interview in Japanese. It was not good. But like, the thing is that like, I'm used to doing the work I'm doing in English, and I don't have the vocabulary to talk about it in Japanese, because you don't just randomly, it doesn't just float out, you know, like if you don't do the work in the language that you're doing, if you don't do it in that language, you're not going to know the terminology. So you hajimoshite. I had that embarrassment. Yeah.
Okay. We provided J1's initiation of the story sharing, just to give you some context. We don't really have time to show our analysis of her story as well, because that is also very interesting. But we're going to focus on the second two stories that are shared afterwards. And the second one is by H1, right? And just to give you some background about H1, This participant was raised in the US and said that she often spoke a mix of English and Japanese with her mother growing up. She rated her English as 5 out of 5 and Japanese as 4 out of 5 in the beginning of the exchange, which means that she feels very fluent in Japanese, but sometimes has trouble with, you know, very specialized words or terminology. Okay, so let's take a look at her story.
So, oh man. Yeah. I feel like I have so many moments where I'm like not confident at speaking Japanese. Yeah. But one of the first jobs I got here, like in New York, because like I was a student at the time, I just like went on Craigslist. I was like bilingual job. So I was like, let me just do something. And I found this actually like production company, and I studied like media and arts at school. So I was like at this production company, I ended up getting this job, but it was like a lot of the work that I was doing was like with like Japanese clientele. And so like, I just felt like a little bit like degraded at some points, because it was like, oh, hana-chan, like, amari nihongo, like, shabudanai, like, you know, kind of just like babied almost. Yeah. And I feel like that happens a lot to me.
Yeah, and like the thing you say with calling you like Maya-chan, sorry, I didn't mean to talk over you, but like, yeah, like it seems like with people who are mixed or people who have international backgrounds, it's okay to call them by their first name and use chang with them and not the same as you would use for a Japanese colleague or a Japanese person.
Always.
Okay. Right, so we analyzed the second narrative, as we mentioned, using the three-level positioning analysis by Bamberg and Giorgio Coppola. And level one focuses on how the characters in the story are positioned in relation to each other and in space and time. So H1 is positioning herself as a student in NYC looking for a bilingual job. And within the story, you know, she's also saying, you know, she just wants to do something. She indicates that she finds a job that she has relevant skills for, since she studied media and arts. And she positions herself as the victim in the sense that she is infantilized by Japanese clients, right? So the complicating action or climax of her story is the acknowledgement that she's often babied, both at this job and in Japan. And unlike J1, H1's resolution is co-constructed, right? So H1, through the validation provided by J1, is able to identify that she was infantilized by her colleagues and clients, and it was not okay to treat her that way. Right, at positioning level two, we look at how speakers position themselves to their audience and what do they accomplish with their story. Right, so H1 is accomplishing three things. First, by providing her story, she's expressing empathy to J1, who just shared her own story of language shame. And then second, of course, she's providing her own expression of language shame. And thirdly, she's expressing kind of a hesitancy in evaluating the event as degrading. Right, at position level three, we look at how does a speaker position a sense of self and identity with regards to dominant discourses and master narratives. Right, so in this sense, we see that J1 is co-constructing the evaluation by linking social level systems, and H1 then upgrades her evaluation because she's removing the hedging language. So, for example, when she starts, she says things like, so like, I just felt like a little bit like degraded. And then that gets upgraded to, yeah, itsumo, after J1 gives her a Japanese phrase, kodomo atsukai sareru, to actually name that experience. So in doing so, this translanguaging space is helping them, or giving them an opportunity to co-construct an evaluation And led to empowerment by helping H1 recognize that she deserved better treatment and respect.
Okay, so now we're going into our last narrative on T1, and so some background on her before we hear her piece of the transcript. She was raised in the United States until age 10, and then moved with her family to Japan, and while there, attended an international school in Japan until she was 18. She rated her English as a 5 out of 5 and her Japanese as a 3 out of 5, mostly speaking English during her meetings, but often mixed in Japanese words and phrases. She also demonstrated a very high level of receptive understanding of the other Hafu women's experiences and just really put forth a lot of empathy towards the other participants. So let's listen to her transcript.
Always.
Yeah, I had the same experience after university. I got a job in New York and I thought, great, I want to work, you know, I was looking for the same thing, sort of Japanese companies maybe. And I worked for a small Japanese company, a branch of it in New York, which was advertising. I did anthropology. I don't know why I went into advertising for 1 year, but it really was only 1 year because I had to quit. And it was like an all-out position, but they were like, no, you're not. And then so basically my job was to serve tea to all the president's like friends who would come over, and oh my God, it had nothing to do with the job itself. And he was like, oh, do I really want to do this? So I was sort of performing the act, but I couldn't speak the language well enough, and it just felt wrong on all sides, so I had to quit. It was really uncomfortable in many ways. My language was, I just ended up speaking English in the end because Nihongo was just so mijakusa, like all over the place.
Oh my God, I feel the same way. The Ocha thing is like a big thing too. I don't understand like what the serving of tea does for like the older, like I feel like male people.
It must just be an ego thing, like having someone serve you tea makes you feel important, I guess. But like, it's power harassment, as you would call it in Japanese. Like, it's just people doing things to make themselves feel better.
And of course I was like really nervous because I was like, oh, I'm gonna remember how to do this properly, you know, like how to hold my hand on the bottom of the teacup and on the side like this, and then, you know, pouring in a particular way and how to serve it. And I just thought, wow, am I doing this right? I don't think I'm doing this right.
You shouldn't have had to do that though. I'm sorry that you went through that.
That's the point, because it was like one of my first jobs, you know, out of university. I'd had a number of jobs throughout, but this was my first kind of real job in an advertising firm. And I thought, wait, is this what it's supposed to be like? The answer was no, but I learned later on that was not right.
So we see in T1's story that, again, going into the positioning analysis, level one, that she too, T1, positions herself as kind of like naive new college graduate who is looking for a job, found one in advertising, even though she studied anthropology, but mostly trying to connect with and use her Japanese heritage and background. We see the climax of her story, or the complicating action, as T1 feeling her Japanese was too mechakucha, too messed up to work there, and that she had to quit. And the way she talks about it is like there was no other option based on her own evaluation. Resolution of her story was, again, through the support of J1, that she shouldn't have had to feel that way, to feel this discomfort and this shame of how she reflected on her own presentation there. Moving to level two in the analysis, we see T1 accomplishing two things in her story. Similar to the other participants, we see that through her story and expressed in sharing with the group, she demonstrates empathy and solidarity to the other participants. And second, she expressed shame and extreme discomfort at this job on multiple levels, due to her perceived lack of Japanese skill and denial of her Japanese identity related to her physical appearance. Lastly, the level three positioning, we see her story through J1 linking power harassment and gender roles, or pahara for power harassment, for T1, it did not immediately result in the uptake of empowerment, and J1 helps to help T1 take a stronger stance about this. And however, linking T1's experience to these larger systemic issues facilitated healing through this validation and solidarity amongst all three participants, and empowerment through acknowledging that the problem is not T1's Japanese language or cultural knowledge, but the historic systems of injustice related to systemic gender norms and race.
Right, so to summarize, all three participants had strong memories of marginalized experiences. All three participants worked in three different Japanese companies at three different stages of their career, and yet their strongest memories are of marginalization due to linguistic repertoires, their racial appearance, and gender. we also see collective healing that Hafu women achieved through repeated expressions of empathy, such as, "Oh man," or "Yeah," or "Itsumo." So things where they're kind of, they're giving some back channeling. And also co-constructed evaluation of their stories that linked their experiences to social discourses condoning racial discrimination and sexism in Japan. Right. Interestingly though, we don't really see so much linguistic empowerment, and yeah, they didn't seem to achieve this with their current, they didn't seem to achieve, you know, empowerment and a better feeling about their current linguistic abilities or discuss the ethnolinguistic discrimination as a social issue. Right? And we speculate that this may be due to just a lack of awareness about topics that are perhaps more discussed in academia rather than, in our social world, such as raciolinguistics and translanguaging. So raciolinguistics, just put it briefly, the way that we tend to correlate race and language. So we see a race and we assume a certain language practice and vice versa.
So moving into our discussion, we found that there were intersectional experiences of racism, sexism, and linguistic discrimination across all three women's stories. So we see that all three women's purpose was to share stories about language shame, the initial question they were responding to. However, they all ended up discussing experiences of racism and sexism, which is related to the multiracial anxieties of not being enough. What we surmise from these exchanges is that it's impossible to dissociate language or dissociate race, gender, and language from the intersectional roles they play as multiracial women. And we wanted to talk about a few cases in particular. So looking at each one first, her experience of intersectional experience of racism, sexism, and linguistic discrimination, see that H1 related the way she was infantilized due to the perceptions of her language. So chanting her, as J1 says, or she says, "Amare Nihongo Shabaranai," she can't really speak Japanese, is the comments she received. And other Hafu women attributed this to her multiracial appearance rather than her linguistic abilities. And we speculate this may also be due to her salient identity as a woman. And the quote that we have at the bottom was from an article about microaggressions experienced by monoracial Asian women, but we thought it was useful to share here that the fetishization and exotification of Asian women and Asian culture, examples of yellow fever, can be particularly destructive because it reinforces docile, foreign, and childlike stereotypes of Asian women. And we can see that stereotype or microaggression intersecting with H1's story that we're sharing here.
And also we want to talk about another example of T1. So only after she starts receiving she received these comments that she didn't look Japanese, which is a type of monoracism. T1 describes her anxiety with her Japanese language skills and, you know, pouring tea properly. And it kind of suggests that she's having these overcompensatory emotions and behavior. Like she wants to make sure she can do everything perfectly to prove that she belongs there. And this is kind of related to the way that many multiracials, they do use linguistic and cultural capital to as an important means to prove their ethnic identities. Due to their ambiguous racial appearance. Okay, and of course, this could lead to increased anxiety when they're using their heritage language due to painful experiences of identity denial. Right, so we believe our data show the importance of awareness. So specifically about systemic ethnolinguistic discrimination and translanguaging as a political stance. We actually did find another conversation happening in a different breakout room where there was one participant who was a grad student and in applied linguistics and actually learning about these terms. And so when she was able to label another participant's Jenglish as translanguaging, it did lead to really positive uptake and empowerment in that way. We don't have time to share it with you today, but it was really interesting to see. And yeah, it kind of further, gives us evidence that this is really important to be able to name some of the things that we experience. Okay, and then many participants expressed language shame for not speaking enough. And we believe that this stems from internalized ideologies that many of us have, where we kind of see native speakers as superior type speakers. And we have this pressure to compare ourselves with them, even though they are oftentimes just monolingual native speakers. They are not multilingual as many of us are.
So, and we also wanted to, as we mentioned in our intro, safe spaces are both of therapeutic value and active site for construction of resistant values and knowledge. And we want to emphasize from our data the power of testimony, that personal narratives that give voice of experiences and of oppression provide opportunity to create meaning of their individual and collective experiences of oppression and empower individuals to envision future possibilities. And that we need the critical consciousness to label and identify discrimination before we can dismantle it. A little bit of what Aurora was talking about earlier. And we see, because we see tremendous importance for any field working with multiracials to critically reflect on how racial-linguistic ideologies and native speaker superiority shape our interactions, attitudes towards, and expressions of identity.
So that's it for our presentation. We also just wanted to give a quick note that if you enjoyed reading Christine Inzer's graphic comic, clips, then please do check out her work. The clips we used today were from Kokoro, and yeah, we would highly recommend reading it as it resonated strongly with us. Great, thank you so much for listening. Gosei-cho arigatou gozaimashita. And finally, for our Q&A section, we are very happy just to start with questions. And if there aren't questions, we have our own discussion questions to share. Okay, well, if anyone wants to start off, I know the first question always takes the longest, but. If anyone wants to start, please feel free in the chat or out loud.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Sorry. That was a really interesting talk. Something that means a lot to me, both as a Hafu woman and as a linguist. And I was kind of curious about your methodology. I was wondering if one, all of your participants were American, or if they were international. And two, if you saw any differences in regards to the generation they belong to as well. in terms of like first gen, second gen, third gen, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, Yuki, do you want to take this question?
Yeah, so to answer your first question, no, not all of our participants were American. I don't, of the 20, I couldn't give you a good number about who was born and raised in the United States, but I think handful had no relationship to the US, were born outside the US and raised outside the US. Trying to think.
Yeah, there were a handful who were born and raised in Japan, a handful born and raised in the UK. I think they've lived multiple places. They're like, not just the US, but like Amsterdam or yeah, other places. But yeah, there were certainly a good number from the US as well. Okay. And then the second question was about generational differences. Yeah, we had, we had maybe like one participant who is, I would say a lot older, like kind of my own mother's generation, I would say. And it was very interesting to see some of the differences in the way that they participated. But I think the majority of our participants were like in their 20s and 30s. So we only had like maybe one, one or two older people. Yeah, maybe one person in their 40s, one in their 60s maybe. I didn't ask, or at least I shouldn't share it. Anyway, yeah, and I would say it was, everybody had different things that they felt that they could also contribute. Like the older one, I think especially said she really enjoyed providing some support and saying like, it gets better, it gets better. So yeah. Did you have anything to add, Yuki?
I think maybe to answer another part of your question in terms of like the intersection of generation, maybe we had maybe not as much of a age range, but that there was different experience of people who were born in Japan and raised in Japan versus born in the United States and raised here, and their parents' immigration and acculturation levels too. And I do think that there were some differences. I think if most obviously the comfort levels in different languages, the participants that were born and raised in Japan and like visited the United States or came to the UK or the States for college, their sessions predominantly were held in Japanese as opposed to maybe the people who were born outside of Japan, a lot of their sessions were in English and really pushing themselves to various degrees to utilize or use Japanese or just use more vocabulary throughout their sessions. So that's, I think, one broad brush strokes observation difference.
Yeah. Yeah, I hope that answered the question.
May I ask a question, if that's okay? I was just wondering if you could elaborate on the kinds of ground rules you had in creating the safe spaces. Like, were there some that were really unique to the study group that you were dealing with, or?
Maybe I can just share that slide just
to... Okay.
Let's see, where was it? let's see, we try to create these definitely with our specific context in mind. So yeah, there are, I think as Yuki talked about, there are definitely, I think, ground rules that we talked about related to language. So things such as like, don't provide feedback to each other unless you ask for it. I think that was, I guess it's not written here, but you know, this is something that I think we all kind of have to realize that maybe when you make a quote unquote error, it's not actually an error, you know? And so we have to kind of change the way that we think about what is like a language error or what is it that we're trying to communicate. So I'm happy to share like the specific ground rules with you later if you find that might be helpful. But yeah, a lot of our ground rules were related to both language and then also, of course, ones similar to the ones that you presented in the beginning where we're saying like, this is a safe environment, be respectful to everyone. If we find otherwise, we might remove you from the session, those kind of things.
And I will say some of them, I think, stem from like kind of the group psychology, like group therapy spaces where emphasis on, we were, a lot of the questions as we moved through those sessions, we were asking for maybe more vulnerable experiences, like specifically asking of experiences of like discrimination and different stereotypes and microaggressions that people might have experienced. So really emphasizing that this space is confidential and private, and to honor that in a way that is not just respectful of everyone's speaking and opinions, but that people are sharing are being asked to share vulnerable topics, and that it's a choice and a decision of the person to share or not share. So I guess that's a slightly unique aspect to our ground rules, in addition to the things that Aurora had already mentioned.
If no one has a question, can I ask one?
Cool.
I have two questions, but I think I'm just going to focus on one for now. I'm curious to know what your ideas might be for your next steps of this research. Like, would it be maybe like a further analysis of the data you already have, or maybe like going back to touch bases with participants? Would it, for example, be focusing on different types of Hafu? For example, maybe people that would be not necessarily easy to find through Facebook, for example, or in like these Hafu communities? Would it be like with people who identify as Hafu men?
So many things coming up in my mind, but I don't know, Yuki, did you have anything? I'm interested to hear about this too.
Well, I know we've talked briefly about like taking a narrative analysis in a different kind of way. I know in like psychology, we have like narrative therapy, and I've talked about this before with Aurora, just like how narrative therapy is used a lot of times to unpack and rewrite the story of one's trauma, and how that could be very interesting on some of the experiences that our participants shared. So that is an avenue, I think, that could be very interesting to go down. As we talked about a little bit earlier before this started, I'm very interested in like colorism and how that impacts people's experiences of microaggressions and stereotypes. And as a person who does not identify as part white or European in my Hafu makeup, I am really interested in connecting with other people of what I've kind of been trying to explore more, which is dual marginalized racial identities. So like coming from two minority backgrounds and how that impacts one's ability. Especially when the other background maybe requires other language abilities or has other like cultural expectations of you that are different from like a majority like white Western European expectation. So I'd be very interested in finding a community like that, but that is a lot harder because statistically it's smaller. And of course, I think with a lot of, at least in psychology, I'm very familiar with the distrust of participating in studies like this, to connect with communities that have been underserved and misused by research, and to help them feel like co-collaborators and equals and not like a person being examined and studied. So that's, I think, future directions, and Aurora will help me figure that out along the way.
I absolutely, I don't know, it just, the things that Yuki is talking about, I think, are so important, so incredibly important, because, yeah, we have to realize, you know, there is a huge community, and there's so much heterogeneity within Hafu, within heritage language learners. You know, there's so much, and we need to understand the experiences of, you know, the spectrum within, you know, these people who may identify under the same label, but have quite different experiences. So yeah, I mean, looking at the experiences of people with perhaps dual minority backgrounds, I think is so important to understand. And I hope Yuki and I can work together on that. When we did our like thematic analysis and we kept talking about the data, one of our research assistants is male. And so he would say like, wow, I never had this a lot, actually. And also, I've noticed within, you know, the research I've done so far that a lot of the participants who volunteer to do research on race-related topics tend to be female. And I think there is a reason for that, but I don't think it's been explored in depth much at all, especially with multiracial populations. So yeah, definitely that's something I'm interested in looking at in the future. It's just, yeah, it's like part of the long-term research agenda.
Part of the book.
Cool, thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please. Okay.
Hi, thank you very much for that presentation. I'm also applied linguist in training, and I love narrative analysis. And I had a question about your, I guess, methodology kind of early on, that like how for your recording, because you're recording these very intimate conversations, right? How, like, what was the process in getting your participants comfortable with each other and to a stage where you could say, like, can I record this conversation? Or did they know from the very start that you'd be recording all of it? Can you kind of walk through that process?
Yeah, I mean, they knew from the start when we explained the study to them and had them, you know, do the IRB consent forms, that they were going to be recorded throughout. And we were a little bit surprised, actually, in that it seems like many of them felt very comfortable with each other, even from the first session that they met. And I think maybe that shows a lot in terms of like how having an environment with people who look like you can really change things. I mean, just that alone, I think people were sharing, felt a lot more comfortable. And I can't say all the reasons why, but I think, you know, what Grills is talking about in terms of like having people who have diverse experiences, but still there's overlap in so many of the things that they talk about. I think that immediately made it just much easier for them to share stories.
To add on a very logistical level, they did get the questions in advance too. So they knew ahead of time and were actually asked to like fill in in a response ahead of time, like what they would like to say, both in a way to help people feel prepared if they wanted to share it in English or Japanese, depending on what language they wanted to use. And I think more subconsciously to make sure everyone was able to think through a little bit what experience or story they might want to share and give them a chance to reflect in case that it was particularly vulnerable or risky for them. So it wasn't like in vivo, they were finding out the conversation, like, can you share a microaggression experience or a time of language shame? And then maybe saying something before they had a chance to, let me think about it and really make sure I feel prepared, safe, and okay to share this.
Yeah, I think that was really important. Thanks for adding that.
Thank you. And as a quick follow-up, for both of you as the researchers, were you present in these breakout rooms or?
We were like omnipresent in like the Zoom, the Zoom halo back here, but we were there.
We weren't talking much, but we were like just peeping in.
Yeah, there was a lot of breakout rooms at some point. So we had a lot of laptops up trying to pop in.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Hello, hi Aurora. Hello everyone. First, I just want to say thank you all so much for creating this event, and then to Aurora and to Yuki as researchers for sharing this with us. And it definitely feels very personal to me too. And the question I had was for Aurora and Yuki. I was curious about your experience as researchers working with a group of people who you share so much experientially with in terms of heritage and maybe relate to in terms of the feelings about language and some of the personal things that the people in your study had talked about. I was wondering, you know, in that question of healing that kind of came at the end, if you found that this, like doing the research, was a healing experience, or if there were things about it that were difficult, you know, having that kind of the shared, maybe some of the difficult feelings that came out in the study. I was just kind of curious about for you guys, how that was.
Yeah, excellent question. I mean, yeah, Yuki, do you want to start?
Sure. Yeah, that's a lovely question. Thank you for asking it. I think it was, I mean, it's healing in moments, it's therapeutic, of course, to hear people. I mean, there were definitely moments where people were saying, experiencing, sharing stories of different gendered microaggressions, or like almost, I mean, more particularly the stories that people would share where they were kind of soliciting validation of whether something was a microaggression or a stereotype or whether it was a compliment. And I definitely have identified with that, where it's like, was I supposed to be offended by that? Because I think I might be offended by that. But also I got recognized as my part of my background, so that felt kind of good. And watching people sit with very complex emotional experiences like that, but with people who very deeply wanted to figure it out with them in a way that people who don't have the same backgrounds maybe won't have the time, space, and depth for. So that was very healing. I think working on this with Aurora has been very healing for me, because it's very rare to find a researcher who shares the similar interests and identities, and we care so much about this and care so much about our participants as people, because they are community members. So it's not top down, it's more like we're all collaborators in this, and hopefully that's reflected in how we talk about and share the information they shared with us. I think a challenge for me is that oftentimes, we didn't talk about this so much in this study, but a lot of our participants talked about white passing as a major component to their stereotype and microaggression experience. And that's something I'm very unfamiliar with. And that is a little, I mean, it's appropriate distancing, but it is something I think that kind of connects to the last, the question Sachi asked, that just demonstrate there is a lot of diversity in the diaspora of Hafus. And in Japan at large, or people with part Japanese ancestry. And it just makes me feel like, oh, and I don't think there was anyone who particularly shared my phenotype, which is just not as white skinned. And so it just shows me the area of growth and also, some differences amongst me and the participants. But Aurora, what about for you?
I mean, yeah, it was definitely, I think, a healing process. Well, a lot of the research I do is kind of like me search, in a sense that it really does heal, because I'm recognizing that I'm not alone in my experiences, of course. And I think that's particularly true in this study, because I suppose we, like for me myself, I'm half, but I'm also like Zainichi half, which is different from a traditional Japanese half, I suppose. So yeah, just like being able to talk about that in a way that everybody is really welcoming and embracing, and still recognizing me as belonging, I think was just really wonderful. And then also, I don't know, I learned so much, many of the Hafu who were raised in Japan, when we talk, we had one question where we were asking, would you identify as like a woman of color? And it was really interesting to see how so many of them said no, or they just didn't know like what that even refers to. And I'm totally overgeneralizing when I say this, but, well, I don't want people to overgeneralize when I say this, but some of the Japanese participants we had really distanced themselves from that term. And they said they just kind of associate person of color with like Black experiences. And they never really had that kind of education about racism in school or, you know, in society. So it was really interesting to see how that kind of was very different, I think, for some of the US-raised participants, who very strongly identified as people of color, person of women of color, because of, you know, history of Japanese internment in the US, as well as other reasons. So yeah, just kind of learning from our participants, like you can have all of these different ways that you identify. And there's no like way we have to identify, but yeah, we are all very different in what we learn to be, quote unquote, true, I suppose. Yeah, so that was really interesting learning experience for me.
Thank you both so much. Yeah, I really loved, I loved to hear about the research that you did, but also it's so encouraging to see like your dynamic in working together as researchers. And yeah, just thank you again so much.
Thank you, sir.
All right. It is 9:02 p.m. Eastern time. So I would like to wrap this up by, again, thanking Dr. Tsai and Dr. Yamazaki for delivering that really insightful talk. I learned a lot, and I really look forward to your future research. Sachi, would you like to say some last words?
No, I think, Mimi, you probably summed it up quite nicely. Thank you again for joining us, and thanks to all the participants here today for joining us as well. So interesting. And yeah, I think we're all looking forward to the next steps and see what happens from here. So, arigatou gozaimasu.